We're coming to you from historic Turner Hall in downtown Milwaukee. This week, Wisconsin politics, blue, red, or jumbled. Welcome to 4th Street Forum. I'm Marcus White, your host for MPTV's 4th Street Forum. Thank you for joining us this week. I'm excited about this week's topic because it seems like we have been through a long cycle in our state of elections, recall elections, and then more elections. With the inauguration of the president just a few days away, we have something of a bookend on that season. We have some terrific guests with us today to help us look at this, to look at not only where we have been as a state, but maybe where it is that we're headed. So let's get right to it and take a moment to introduce our guests. Our first guest is Professor Charles Franklin. His is a name we all became familiar with during the 2012 presidential election. As director of the Marquette University Law Poll, he correctly predicted within a single percentage point the governor's recall election, the U.S. Senate, and presidential elections. He is a UW-Madison political science professor and the founder of PollsAndVotes.com. Charles, welcome.
Thank you.
Daryl Maureen is the former state director of the League of United Latin American Citizens, an organization addressing civil rights, education, economic, and political issues. LULAC is the oldest and largest Hispanic membership-based organization in the country. Mr. Maureen also owns his own technology business. Daryl, welcome.
Thank you. It's good to be here with you today.
And Professor Margaret Hankinson is the chair of the Political Science Department at UW-Waukesha. Professor Hankinson's research interests include media and politics, American election campaigns, and women and public policy. Margaret, welcome back.
Thank you.
Daryl. You know, we often hear about Latino voters and immigration as an issue, but I'm fairly confident that immigration is not the only issue on the mind of Latino voters. What are the kinds of issues that brought voters to the polls last year?
Well, it's very interesting, and we have seen a little bit of a shift there, as you mentioned. Immigration continues to play a very important role. And above and beyond, I think the issue of immigration or where Latinos stand on it, there's been a lot of divisive rhetoric. And that's actually driven some people away. But other issues, by far and away, the most important issue over this last campaign season has been one of employment.
Okay. Yep.
Latinos traditionally have one of the lowest unemployment percentages of any group out there. However, no one's been harder hit during this economic downturn than the Latino community. So that was factor number one that everyone was looking at. After that was followed by immigration, and then education and access to healthcare were other key and critical components of things they were looking at when they went to the voting booth.
Great. Presidential elections. I want to ask Daryl about trends. I think it may have been the Bush-Gore election where it was pretty much a 50-50 split among Latino voters in the United States, but that seems to have shifted dramatically. LULAC addresses a lot of different issues. Why is it that we've seen such a pronounced shift?
It's interesting. I'm glad you asked that question. And I think what we're going to see here, and I'll just do this as an overlay, is we're going to see the national politics really starting to play more locally as well when it comes to Latino voters. Because when you look at our governor, obviously there's national aspirations there, or he's signaling that way. When you look at Congressman Paul Ryan, obviously, people are already talking about him and his potential run for a presidential. So things that they're going to do here locally are going to have national implications, right? And while we know that the Latino community is growing exponentially across the country, the fastest growing demographic in the country, as well as here in Wisconsin, still the numbers are a little bit smaller here in Wisconsin than they are nationally. So I think we're going to see these figures starting to position themselves to appeal to the larger Latino base. Mm-hmm. So they're in position to win those key swing states that are out there. So just to put that there. But to come back to your question, the Latino community in Wisconsin has grown 74% in the last 10 years.
Yeah, can you give us a bit of context? I don't know if everyone how big is the Latino community in Wisconsin?
Okay, so we have about per the 2010 census, about 330,000 Latinos here in the state. And a lot of people have preconceptions as to what a Latino looks like, dark skin, those types of things. But there are actually a lot of people with white complexions that are categorized as Latino or Hispanic, et cetera, and African or people of darker color, Black Americans, that are actually Hispanic as well. So you're seeing about 130,000 of those are voting age. We also know that we continue to be the fastest growing demographic in the state. So while the numbers aren't considerable yet, I think if you went to either party chair right now, they would love to say, I have that 130,000 or 150,000 votes that are out there. So I think you're going to continue to see Latino influence predominantly in the more contested races, which is what we're mm-hmm. seeing right now. And especially when you look at the local, county, state, and even the state level where we've done things with regards to redistricting here in Milwaukee.
The judge ordered redrawing two districts, right, because of the need for better representation.
At the state level.
Right.
There's now been some changes at county government here in Milwaukee County. And for the first time ever, Latinos now have a Latino-dominated district here within MPS. So I think you're going to continue to see that influence as we move further.
Mm-hmm. Great. When you mentioned Texas being sort of a solidly Republican state, but apparently that's likely to change in the next few years, and that's attributed largely to the Latino community. And Daryl, I want to ask you, you mentioned the school board. Of course, those elections are coming up in April here in Milwaukee. But at all kinds of levels of government, do you feel that the Latino community is well enough represented?
And that's an excellent question. And I'm going to take just one quick step back to something you had asked earlier before. From the Latino community, over the last few years, absent going all the way back to Karl Rove, there really hasn't been a significant fight by the parties over the Latino community. You have the Republicans here as of late that have pretty much written off the Latino community because of some of the very divisive rhetoric that was coming out of certain members of the party. And then you had the Democratic Party feeling like they really didn't have to do a whole lot to win the Hispanics, that they were going to show up on voting day and do that until this last year, when the president showed pretty significant disapproval ratings in the Latino community.
Yeah.
And then some people suggest that there was an action he took called deferred action. Mm-hmm. That is a temporary residency status for undocumented immigrants who came at a young age and went to school, et cetera. That was hugely popular in the Latino community.
The action that he took. Because the disappointment was rooted in no comprehensive reform,
correct,
although it had been promised, right?
He had promised that that was going to be one of the first actions he'd take once he got inaugurated. He didn't. He then came back to the Latino community and said, well, we need to tackle this bigger picture issue of health care first. Mm-hmm. And if you help us pass this, I promise you, the very next thing we're going to move on to is comprehensive immigration reform. And it didn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, not too many people outside the Latino community are aware of this, but he actually deported more undocumented immigrants mm-hmm. than George Bush ever did.
Interesting.
So, There was quite a bit of frustration there,
okay,
that culminated in last year him really having to pass this deferred action to get himself over
in order to get back in good favor.
Correct.
Yeah, good.
Correct.
Daryl, you know, Margaret mentioned the open for business slogan, and one of the first things the governor did after he was sworn in January 2011 was go and declare the state open for business and put signs up on our welcome signs. You're a business owner. Do you feel like over the last couple of years, Wisconsin has become more business friendly or is moving in that direction?
I think it's still a little bit too early to tell. I know there's another wave of initiatives that the governor spoke about yesterday at the State of the State address. I think it's the jury's still out on that. And how much of that is just a recovering economy, although it is coming at a slower pace, and how much of that is an initiative. So I think we'll have a better idea in the next couple of years. But to say that, I think it's great for marketing purposes. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if we could actually say we've seen the gains we've seen just because of his programs.
And are you getting any signs? Are there early indicators that indeed the economy is improving?
Yes, we are. We provide high technology to a lot of Wisconsin, in fact, some of our country's largest firms. And we do now see consistent increases in capital spending.
Yeah.
So if you see manufacturers and distributors and retailers start to invest more in their infrastructure, it means they see better days ahead. So we're very hopeful that will continue.
Great. Daryl?
I'd like to just echo what you said. You know, I used to think of the country as a pendulum. We'd swing to the left, we'd eventually come back to the middle, swing to the right, et cetera. But with this new media and the electronic media, I won't just say the TV, boy, I've seen that pendulum. It feels like it's just split in half,
yeah,
right? And it's gone to the extreme on both sides.
Yeah.
And I know there's been a number of different issues, whether it's immigration, whether it's healthcare, whether it's education, where I've gone to Washington and spoken with leaders on quite a bit. And then I go up and I watch this one particular channel, and there's this panel of very likable people that are apparently experts in every field that they get interviewed on every day. And so I find myself watching channels on various, with various agendas or biases or whatever you want to call it. and then just to get a perspective of it. But I really want to encourage the viewers at home to really start to do your own research, start to learn more, because these talking heads out there really can't be experts in everything. Yeah. And I've seen things stated as fact that were categorically false. You know, so everybody, yes, it is an easy way to get information, but just because you see a 1 minute or 2 minute spot on the news doesn't make you an expert on education or healthcare or immigration,
etc. That's a great point, that we do see the same experts talking about every topic under the sun. Now, let me ask you about social media, because in the Latino community, there's a large young population, and is social media the way candidates are going to reach the younger voters?
It really has. People have said, why are we starting to see such an increase, not just in the number of votes, because the population is growing, but in the number of people who are participating in the process. We now have second, third generation, et cetera, Latinos here that are growing up more connected. And by being more connected, they have access to more information, are becoming more involved, and are choosing not only to go out and get involved and vote, but to organize as well. So I think when you look at Twitter, when you look at Facebook, when you look at some of these others, you're really seeing people from around the country have a cost-effective way of connecting to take on a belief or a project that they want to do. And we are seeing it growing exponentially amongst our membership and the other organizations as well.
It'll be interesting when we see the day where a candidate, perhaps a major candidate at a city council level or a mayor of a city, someone gets elected without having spent any advertising or robocall dollars, but they do all of their outreach through social media. That's got to be happening soon.
Let me just say, I'll be a big fan of doing away with the robocalls. We mentioned that earlier. So,
well, we mentioned that the healthcare reform got done first, and where does it stand? Is that your question?
Yes.
Well, in the short term, it's still quite up in the air. 2013 is the year in which most of the important elements of Obama's healthcare reform get implemented in the states. We won't see those actually have an impact until 2014. So we have a year of transition, but a year in which many of the states, ours included, have said that rather than work on developing those policies at the state level, they're just going to let the federal government handle it. This leads more uncertainty, and from a business perspective, I'd be interested in what you have to say about where that leaves us. Uncertainty is the easy answer.
I can tell you a lot of businesses, especially large corporations located here in the state, are very concerned, because when you try to look into that crystal ball and to forecast what things are going to look like moving forward, it's very, very muddy right now. And when that is the case, you are less, you're more risk averse, I should say, to growth, which obviously has an impact here. But yeah, when Governor Walker came out and said, no, we're not going to do anything, we'll let the federal government look at it, it just heightened the level of anxiety. I think people are feeling.
And the uncertainty, and therefore, not taking as many risks. Daryl? Yeah.
I'm just going to jump in here really quick, too, a combination of both of your questions from earlier. There was another change in process here, which actually didn't get recognized by a lot of folks. And it was based right here in Milwaukee. Based on the 2010 census, the municipality did go over the limit of non-first language speakers being English, where it did have to implement a Spanish-speaking voting system for the first time in the city's history. So I think there was a lot of press written up about the Department of Justice having to come in and do monitoring, et cetera. So there was a change in the process. And to your question earlier, it's one of those things that has added to the participation. And a lot of people I hear out there, well, if you don't know English, you shouldn't be voting. But for a lot of people where you may be bilingual, you're always more comfortable, right? Sure. You're always more comfortable in your native language. Sure. And for people who may not have had the education or may not have that as their first language or may not have easy access to a poll, to know that you can go there and ask a question in a language you're comfortable with makes all the difference in the world in getting the percentage rates up. So,
thank you. Daryl?
From the Hispanic community, boy, we're just excited to see both parties engaging us again in earnest. So we're excited to see where that goes. But when we talk to our membership and other folks throughout the community, we see long-term economic health is actually creeping its way up there. You wouldn't think about that being it, but the economy will continue to be the driver just in different ways.
Will you all join me in thanking our guests? Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you. Next week, please join me for the new workplace reality. Whether we're talking about fast food workers or professors, we are in an era of lower pay, no benefits, and no security. If that's the future, What does it mean for the next generation and the American dream? For more information on 4th Street Forum or to see previous programs, go to the 4th Street Forum page at mptv.org. Thank you for joining us this week. Thanks for being part of the conversation. Let's keep talking.
Funding was made possible in part by the Milwaukee Turners, which started 4th Street Forum to honor member Frank Zeidler by promoting fair, open, and civil discussion about issues that are important to our community.